Okay, thank you. So we've been having a talk about creating games, so maybe it's time to play a game. So this is Pong, and this is actually a real working game of Pong. I'm controlling it myself here with the keyboard. And it's actually more than a game of Pong, it's two games of Pong. This is the blue player and the green player playing each other over a network. And in this case, it's a simulated network. And I can increase the network message delay as I play this game. So let's turn this up to half a second. And what we see now is that as I move the blue paddle down there, the green player sees it with a slight delay. And this has problems. So if you look closely, suddenly if I overlay the games again, we see that there's now two balls flying around. And you might also notice that both players are winning, because from both players' point of view, the other player is doing completely bogus things. So let's play a game of spot the bug. What went wrong here? And it's pretty obvious what went wrong. So you saw that because of the network delay, the other player saw your actions too late. So while you moved your paddle in front of the ball in time, the other player thought you didn't move your paddle in time, and the ball passed the paddle, and suddenly the game is in a inconsistent state between the two players. And that's because we had a too simple network model. So when one player was interacting with the game, it was transmitting the message to the other player, and only at the time when you receive this, the other player will take it into account. And that doesn't quite work very well. Now, this problem isn't new. It has been around since we play games online. And also, solutions aren't new. So the most obvious and common solution for this is lockstep simulation. Has been around at least since the time of Doom. And the idea is quite simple. The idea is that as we send a message over the network, we also include the time this event has happened. And time means relative to the starting point of the game, so it's game time. And when the other player receives this event, it it sees this message coming in, and it's telling it, well, the other player has pressed a button 200 milliseconds ago. And then what you can do is you can rewind the state of the game by 200 milliseconds, take into account what the other player has been doing at this time, and then fast forward to the current time, replaying anything that has happened in between. Sounds straightforward. So let's do this. So here again, we have two games of Pong, and I've implemented this. So let me bounce this ball off and then increase the network delay. And you will see that the other player, the one that is not highlighted with black, is lagging behind a little bit. But as soon as the message comes in, the paddle was in the right position. And if you were looking real closely, there was a brief moment where there was two balls in the game. Because on the one machine, the ball passed the paddle and was reset to the corner. But after, I guess, less than 400 milliseconds, that player learned that actually its opponent had the paddle in the right position. And now we have one ball again. So all is great? Or do we have a problem? Does anybody see a problem? You're free to shout in what you see. Say again? The score. OK. So if you look at the corner, there's a difference in score. And it's not the same, and it's far too big. And what is the problem here? Well, as it's usual in these conferences, we have t-shirts to answer questions. The problem is mutable state. So you could imagine a novice programmer implementing this game, and he has made Pong, and it works. And now he adds the feature of adding scores. And he's doing it in, let's say, your favorite language, Perl. So the obvious way of doing that is you introduce a variable global to the program where you count the number of scores each player had made. And once the ball passes the paddle, you increase this variable by one. But now I just told you that because of the way we do networking, we have to be able to go back in time and replay the events. So if there was a score scored as you replay the events, you will just be incrementing the count again. And that's why we have there a 4 instead of, I think, should be a 1 at this point. And even worse, it can happen that the ball passes the paddle according to what you see of the world. But then you learn actually the other player had moved his pedal fast enough and the ball didn't actually pass the pedal and you put the ball where it's supposed to be, but you've already incremented the counter and things are wrong. So mutable state is kind of annoying when you try to implement lockstep simulation. So let's fix the mutable state, and we can do that if you're careful. And now we have a different version of the game. And now we can play spot the bug. So it nicely resets, and we don't have the problem with the counter. But let me just miss the ball. And OK, now again, we have two balls, meaning the two players have different ideas. So what has happened here? Can anybody want to show in a keyboard? Random numbers, thank you. You might have noticed that the ball is always starting with a different angle when you reset the game. So the obvious way that our beloved novice Paul programmer would do this is, well, he needs a random number, so he calls rand, this nice global function that gives you a random number whenever you need one. But in this context, this is horribly wrong, because now we have the two machines calculating the game state independently, and they're both calling rand to get a random number, and the likelihood that they get the same number is unfortunately very low. So as soon as you draw a random number, things break. So again, we see that lockstep simulation doesn't quite well go with effects in general. And I found this quote on the internet of a professional game developer who said that one of the most vile bugs in the universe is the desync bug. And I'll skip the next line. The grand assumption to the entire engine architecture is that all players are being fully synchronous. What happens if they aren't? What happens if the simulations diverge? Chaos, anger, and suffering, as we've just seen. And I guess you can see where I'm taking this. And obviously, I'm very much preaching to the choir here, but maybe you like to have a little sermon to tell other people. Namely that if you use the right programming language, something that's pure, functional, and statically typed, like Haskell, all these problems disappear. And indeed, I can implement this game in Haskell and not try hard to introduce these bugs that you've seen. And now everything works fine, which is actually not interesting to see. Now, this wouldn't be a very interesting story if I just had implemented Pong in a way that works over the network nicely. But in fact, this Haskell is so great at this that it allows us to implement lockstep simulation, which is infamously hard for professional programmers and other paradigms who are trying to implement for a single particular game where they know everything about the game. And we implemented it in complete generality, this requiring no discipline whatsoever from the user of our system. And in fact, I'd like to tell you about the context where we implemented lockstep simulation, which is CodeWorld. The CodeWorld is a web-based programming environment created by Chris Smith in the Bay Area to teach math and programming to middle schoolers who have no prior programming experience whatsoever. And what I find impressive is that he's using real Haskell to teach them. So he has two modes, and in one of them he replaces the prelude with something a bit more suitable for middle schoolers, but otherwise it's still real Haskell. And he's quite successful with this. So I'm happy to advertise this project here. And the reason why it works so well, or one of the reasons, is that he tries hard to provide the students with the most abstract, high-level, and simple interface for the task that they want to perform. So they start with using this function. And this is what they call in the main function, nothing else. And then they pass to drawing off a description of a picture in a nice compositional API for graphics, very much inspired by Ben Lippmeyer's gloss. And then the students write, or the pupils, I guess, depending on your country, simple code like this. I will not explain the code. And then they get static pictures. And then because static pictures get boring after a while, they also can start to animate their pictures, and they're moving. And animated pictures are also, well, eventually they get bored with that. And then they start creating interactive programs. So let me show you the interface for an interactive program. And it's not very surprising what you have to do. You choose your game state, the type variable s, and it can be anything you want. It can even be unserializable. It can contain infinite lists or functions and whatnot, if you want. And then you specify how this changes over time, given a time delta. You specify how it changes when a use event comes in. Event is a simple data type that describes mouse movements and button presses, and you show or you describe how to draw the picture. And then you can create interactive programs. And an example is what you see right here. The whole presentation, including all animations, games, network simulations, everything is one big call of this function. And then that's also the reason why I only have a square canvas to draw on, because that's what CodeVault gives me. And this allows them to create interesting and creative games. And we wanted to give them the ability to play the games that they create over the internet with their friends. And again, the question is, what is the most simple abstract interface that we can provide them to perform this task? And we came up with this. It's very simple, and they're also very similar to what you see before. So we just have to additionally say how many players we have. That's the first parameter. And then when you react to an event, you want to know which player actually did this particular mouse press or keyboard press. And also when you draw the game state, you may, if you want, present it differently for different players. And we figured this is the most, like we couldn't really remove anything of this API without compromising what we want to do. But notice that there's no mention of network messages, there's no mention of serializing data, there's no mention of reacting to things that come in late. So all that is hidden from the user, and they can think in their nice abstract model of both players, no matter where they are, interacting over the network, interacting directly with one global computer, so to say. So in the paper, there's a bit more. In particular, there's some tricks about handling time, and actually, just in the previous talk, he was mentioning this problem that you need to make sure that you have the right time steps in for your simulations in between. There's still the question, how do we ensure that the same functions are being passed to this function? And there are two tricks that we apply. We can abuse the module system of Haskell, or we can abuse the feature of static pointers, depending on the mode that the user is in. You might have qualms about floating point numbers, but actually it works out pretty nicely. Floating point numbers are deterministic enough if you don't call transcendental functions like sine and cosine. And we have a way of patching that. And actually, the last bit is one that, since I'm surprisingly fast, will be happy to elaborate here. So if you think about a first-person shooter, like Counter-Strike, that some of you might have played in earlier years, it can happen that you think, or your computer thinks, that I'm standing here, but actually I've moved already to the right. And what doesn't happen then is that I simply jump to the right in one instantaneous moment, but rather the game slowly moves me to the new position in a more or less smooth manner. So it is interpolating in space between the state that it believes the system is in and the state it learns it actually is in. And this creates a nicer user experience for some projects or some programs. Now it seems that in our very general setting, where we have the state variable s, which is completely abstract, we don't really have a way of doing that. And the interesting thing that we found is that there is a way of doing that. And even though we can't interpolate positions in the space of the game, we can interpolate in time. So let's say I'm here, and now I learned that you moved your pedal to a new position 200 milliseconds ago. So right now what I described is, okay, instantaneously I rewind the state, apply your event, and fast forward to the current state, and then continue on, which makes your pedal jump to the new position. But what I can do is I can, for a moment, pretend that you just did it right now, as in the very first version of the game where things were broken. But then as my time moves forward, I slide back the time and I assume you did your event until the real time. And assuming state updates are continuous, which they more or less often are, you get a smooth display. And I want to show this here. So here's our first-person shooter. Nobody's getting shot. And if I move the blue one, we see that so the one with the, maybe it's nicer like this. You see that it jumps back rather abrupt when it learns about the new state. So the green one, it doesn't. So if I start moving the green, let's get this out of the way. If I start moving the green one, for the other player, it just catches up more quickly. It moves more quickly, but it moves to the right position. And it's a neat trick, and it's not really deep, but I find it a very nice observation that it's possible to interpolate despite having no insight whatsoever into the game state. We don't actually do this in the real code world instance because it yields other artifacts, and it's unclear which kind of artifacts are more pleasant. And for reasons of simplicity, we don't allow the user to choose between these methods. But in a more realistic setting or more serious setting than educational programming, this might be an option. Yeah, that's all I wanted to tell you. If you're bored with the next talks, you can play Pong online. over the Wi-Fi here, it should work, and let me know how it goes. You can see the Pong code if you want to make the game better, and if you don't believe that all you've seen here on the screen has been implemented in Code World, you can see the code there on Code World. So thank you.